Recorded Books and One Click Digital present The Girl Who Drank the Moon by Kelly Barnhill. Narrated by Christina Moore. Chapter 1. In which a story is told. Yes. There is a witch in the woods. There has always been a witch. Will you stop your fidgeting for once? My stars, I have never seen such a fidgety child. No, sweetheart, I have not seen her. No one has. Not for ages. We've taken steps so that we will never see her. Terrible steps. Don't make me say it. You already know, anyway. Oh, I don't know, darling. No one knows why she wants children. We don't know why she insists that it must always be the very youngest among us. It's not as though we could just ask her. She hasn't been seen. We make sure that she will not be seen. Of course she exists. What a question. Look at the woods. So dangerous. Poisonous smoke and sinkholes and boiling geysers and terrible dangers every which way. Do you think it is so by accident? Rubbish! It was the witch! And if we don't do as she says, what will become of us? You really need me to explain it? I'd rather not. Oh, hush, now don't cry. It's not as though the Council of Elders is coming for you now, is it? You're far too old. From our family? Yes, dearest. Ever so long ago. Before you were born. He was a beautiful boy. Now finish your supper and see to your chores. We'll all be up early tomorrow. The day of sacrifice waits for no one, and we must all be present to thank the child who will save us for one more year. Your brother? How could I fight for him? If I had, the witch would have killed us all, and then where would we be? Sacrifice one or sacrifice all, that is the way of the world. We couldn't change it if we tried. Enough questions. Off with you. Fool child. Chapter 2. In which an unfortunate woman goes quite mad. Grand Elder Gerland took his time that morning. The day of sacrifice only came once a year, after all, and he liked to look his best during the sober procession to the cursed house and during the somber retreat. He encouraged the other elders to do the same. It was important to give the populace a show. He carefully dabbed rouge on his sagging cheeks and lined his eyes with thick streaks of coal. He checked his teeth in the mirror, ensuring they were free of debris or goop. He loved that mirror. It was the only one in the Protectorate. Nothing gave Gerland more pleasure than the possession of a thing that was unique unto him. He liked being special. The Grand Elder had ever so many possessions that were unique in the Protectorate. It was one of the perks of the job. The Protectorate, called the Cattail Kingdom by some and the City of Sorrows by others, was sandwiched between a treacherous forest on one side and an enormous bog on the other. Most people in the Protectorate drew their livelihoods from the bog. There was a future in bog walking, mothers told their children. Not much of a future, you understand, but it was better than nothing. The bog was full of xeran shoots in the spring, and xeran flowers in the summer, and xeran bulbs in the fall. In addition to a wide array of medicinal and borderline magical plants that could be harvested, prepared, treated, and sold to the traders from the other side of the forest, who in turn transported the fruits of the bog to the free cities far away. The forest itself was terribly dangerous and navigable only by the road. And the elders owned the road. Which is to say that Grand Elder Gerland owned the road, and the other elders had their cut. The elders owned the bog, too, and the orchards, and the houses, and the market squares, even the garden plots. This was why the families of the Protectorate made their shoes out of reeds. This was why, in lean times, they fed their children the thick, rich broth of the bog, hoping that the bog would make them strong. This was why the elders and their families grew big and strong and rosy-cheeked on beef and butter and beer. The door knocked. "Enter," Grand Elder Gerlin mumbled as he adjusted the drape of his robe. It was Antane, his nephew, an elder in training, but only because Gerland, in a moment of weakness, had promised the ridiculous boy's more ridiculous mother. But that was unkind. Antane was a nice enough young man, nearly 13. He was a hard worker and a quick study. He was good with numbers and clever with his hands and could build a comfortable bench for a tired elder as quick as breathing. And despite himself, Gerland had developed an inexplicable and growing fondness for the boy. But Antane had big ideas, grand notions, and questions. Gerland furrowed his brow. Antane was, how could he put it, overly keen. If this kept up, he'd have to be dealt with, blood or no. The thought of it weighed upon Gerland's heart like a stone. "Uncle Gerland!" Antane nearly bowled his uncle over with his insufferable enthusiasm.
"Calm yourself, boy," the elder snapped. "This is a solemn occasion."
The boy calmed visibly, his eager, dog-like face tilted toward the ground. Gerland resisted the urge to pat him gently on the head. "I have been sent," Antane continued in a mostly soft voice, "to tell you that the other elders are ready, and all the populace waits along the route. Everyone is accounted for."
"Each one? There are no shirkers?"
"After last year, I doubt there ever will be again," Antane said with a shudder.
"Pity."
Gerland checked his mirror again, touching up his rouge. He rather enjoyed teaching the occasional lesson to the citizens of the Protectorate. It clarified things. He tapped the sagging folds under his chin and frowned.
"Well, nephew,"
he said with an artful swish of his robes, one that had taken him over a decade to perfect.
"Let us be off. That baby isn't going to sacrifice itself, after all."
And he flowed into the street, with Antane stumbling at his heels. Normally, the day of sacrifice came and went with all the pomp and gravity that it ought. The children were given over without protest. Their numb families mourned in silence, with pots of stew and nourishing foods heaped into their kitchens, while the comforting arms of neighbors circled around them to ease their bereavement. Normally, no one broke the rules. But not this time. Grand Elder Gerland pressed his lips into a frown. He could hear the mothers howling before the procession turned onto the final street. The citizens began to shift uncomfortably where they stood. When they arrived at the family's house, an astonishing sight met the Council of Elders. A man with a scratched-up face and a swollen lower lip and bloody bald spots across his skull where his hair had been torn out in clumps met them at the door. He tried to smile, but his tongue went instinctively to the gap where a tooth had just recently been. He sucked in his lips and attempted to bow instead.
"I am sorry, sirs," said the man, the father, presumably. "I don't know what has gotten into her. It's like she's gone mad."
From the rafters above them, a woman screeched and howled as the elders entered the house. Her shiny black hair flew about her head like a nest of long, writhing snakes. She hissed and spat like a cornered animal. She clung to the ceiling beams with one arm and one leg while holding a baby tightly against her breast with the other arm.
"Get out!" she screamed. "You cannot have her! I spit on your faces and curse your names! Leave my home at once, or I shall tear out your eyes and throw them to the crows!"
The elders stared at her, open-mouthed. They couldn't believe it. No one fought for a doomed child. It simply wasn't done. Antane alone began to cry. He did his best to hide it from the adults in the room. Gerland, thinking fast, affixed a kindly expression on his craggy face. He turned his palms toward the mother to show her that he meant no harm. He gritted his teeth behind his smile. All this kindness was nearly killing him.
"We are not taking her at all, my poor misguided girl," Gerland said in his most patient voice.
The witch is taking her. We are simply doing as we're told.
The mother made a guttural sound deep in her chest, like an angry bear. Gerland laid his hand on the shoulder of the perplexed husband and gave a gentle squeeze.
It appears, my good fellow, that you are right. Your wife has gone mad.
He did his best to cover his rage with a facade of concern.
A rare case, of course, but not without precedent. We must respond with compassion. She needs care, not blame.
Liar! The woman spat.
The child began to cry, and the woman climbed even higher, putting each foot on parallel rafters and bracing her back against the slope of the roof, trying to position herself in such a way that she could remain out of reach while she nursed the baby. The child calmed instantly.
If you take her, she said with a growl, I will find her. I will find her and take her back. You see if I won't.
And face the witch, Gerland laughed, all on your own. Oh, you pathetic, lost soul.
His voice was honey, but his face was a glowing ember.
Grief has made you lose your senses. The shock has shattered your poor mind. No matter, we shall heal you, dear, as best we can. Guards!
He snapped his fingers, and armed guards poured into the room. They were a special unit, provided, as always, by the Sisters of the Star. They wore bows and arrows slung across their backs, and short, sharp swords sheathed at their belts. Their long, braided hair looped around their waists, where it was cinched tight, a testament to their years of contemplation and combat training at the top of the tower. Their faces were implacable as stones, and the elders, despite their power and stature, edged away from them. The sisters were a frightening force, not to be trifled with.
Remove the child from the lunatic's clutches and escort the poor dear to the tower, Gerland ordered.
He glared at the mother in the rafters, who had gone suddenly very pale.
The Sisters of the Star know what to do with broken minds, my dear. I'm sure it hardly hurts at all.
The guard was efficient, calm, and utterly ruthless. The mother didn't stand a chance. Within moments, she was bound, hobbled, and carried away. Her howls echoed through the silent town, ending suddenly when the tower's great wooden doors slammed shut, locking her inside. The baby, on the other hand, once transferred into the arms of the Grand Elder, whimpered briefly and then turned her attention to the sagging face in front of her, all wobbles and creases and folds. She had a solemn look to her, calm, skeptical, and intense, making it difficult for Gerland to look away. She had black curls and black eyes, luminous skin like polished amber. In the center of her forehead, she had a birthmark in the shape of a crescent moon. The mother had a similar mark. Common lore insisted that such people were special. Gerland disliked lore, as a general rule, and he certainly disliked it when citizens of the Protectorate got it in their heads to think themselves better than they were. He deepened his frown and leaned in close, wrinkling his brow. The baby stuck out her tongue.
Horrible child, Gerland thought.
Gentlemen, he said with all the ceremony he could muster,
it is time.
The baby chose this particular moment to let loose a large, warm, wet stain across the front of Gerland's robes. He pretended not to notice, but inwardly he fumed. She had done it on purpose, he was sure of it. What a revolting baby. The procession was, as usual, somber, slow, and insufferably plodding. Gerland felt he might go mad with impatience. Once the Protectorate's gates closed behind them, though, and the citizens returned with their melancholy broods of children to their drab little homes, the elders quickened their pace.
But why are we running, Uncle?
Antane asked.
Hush, boy, Gerland hissed, and keep up.
No one liked being in the forest, away from the road, not even the elders, not even Gerland. The area just outside the Protectorate walls was safe enough. In theory,
but everyone knew someone who had accidentally wandered too far and fell into a sinkhole, or stepped in a mud pot, boiling off most of their skin, or wandered into a swale where the air was bad and never returned. The forest was dangerous. They followed a winding trail to the small hollow surrounded by five ancient trees known as the Witch's Handmaidens. Or six. Didn't it used to be five? Garland glared at the trees, counted them again, and shook his head. There were six. No matter. The forest was just getting to him. Those trees were almost as old as the world, after all. The space inside of the ring of trees was mossy and soft, and the elders laid the child upon it, doing their best not to look at her. They had turned their backs on the baby and started to hurry away when their youngest member cleared his throat.
So, we just leave her here?
Antane asked.
That's how it's done?
Yes, nephew, Garland said. That is how it's done.
He felt a sudden wave of fatigue settling on his shoulders like an ox's yoke. He felt his spine start to sag. Antane pinched his neck, a nervous habit that he couldn't break.
Shouldn't we wait for the witch to arrive?
The other elders fell into an uncomfortable silence.
Come again?
Elder Raspin, the most decrepit of the elders, asked.
Well, surely, Antane's voice trailed off. Surely we must wait for the witch, he said quietly. What would become of us if wild animals came first and carried her off?
The other elders stared at the grand elder, their lips tight.
Fortunately, nephew, he said quickly, leading the boy away, that has never been a problem.
But,
Antane said, pinching his neck again so hard he left a mark.
But nothing,
Garland said, a firm hand on the boy's back, striding quickly down the well-trodden path. And one by one, the elders filed out, leaving the baby behind. They left knowing, all but Antane, that it was not a matter of if the child were eaten by animals, but rather that she surely would be. They left her knowing that there surely wasn't a witch. There never had been a witch. There were only a dangerous forest and a single road and a thin grip on a life that the elders had enjoyed for generations. The witch, that is, the belief in her, made for a frightened people, a subdued people, a compliant people who lived their lives in a saddened haze, the clouds of their grief numbing their senses and dampening their minds. It was terribly convenient for the elders' unencumbered rule. Unpleasant, too, of course, but that couldn't be helped. They heard the child whimper as they tramped through the trees, but the whimpering soon gave way to the swamp sighs and bird song and the woody creaking of trees throughout the forest, and each elder felt as sure could be that the child wouldn't live to see the morning and that they would never hear her, never see her, never think of her again. They thought she was gone forever. They were wrong, of course.
Chapter 3, in which a witch accidentally enmagics an infant. At the center of the forest was a small swamp, bubbly, sulfury, and noxious, fed and warmed by an underground, restlessly sleeping volcano, and covered with a slick of slime whose color ranged from poison green to lightning blue to blood red, depending on the time of year. On this day, so close to the day of sacrifice in the Protectorate, or Star Child Day everywhere else, the green was just beginning to inch its way toward blue. At the edge of the swamp, standing right on the fringe of flowering reeds growing out of the muck, a very old woman leaned on a gnarled staff. She was short and squat and a bit bulbous about the belly. Her crinkly gray hair had been pulled back into a thick braided knot with leaves and flowers growing out of the thin gaps between the twisted plaits. Her face, despite its cloud of annoyance, maintained a brightness in those aged eyes
and a hint of a smile in that flat, wide mouth. From certain angles, she looked a bit like a large, good-tempered toad. Her name was Zan, and she was the witch.
"Do you think you can hide from me, you ridiculous monster?" she bellowed at the swamp. "It isn't as though I don't know where you are. Resurface this minute and apologize."
She pressed her expression into something closely resembling a scowl.
"Or I will make you."
Though she had no real power over the monster himself, he was far too old. She certainly had the power to make that swamp cough him up as if he were nothing more than a glob of phlegm in the back of the throat. She could do it with just a flick of her left hand and a jiggle of her right knee. She attempted to scowl again.
"I mean it," she hollered.
The thick water bubbled and swirled, and the large head of the swamp monster slurped out of the bluish green. He blinked one wide eye and then the other, before rolling both toward the sky.
"Don't you roll your eyes at me, young man," the old woman huffed.
"Witch,"
the monster murmured, his mouth still half submerged in the thick waters of the swamp.
"I am many centuries older than you."
His wide lips blew a bubble in the algae slick.
"Millennia, really," he thought, "but who's counting?"
"I don't believe I like your tone."
Zan puckered her wrinkled lips into a tight rosette in the middle of her face. The monster cleared his throat.
"As the poet famously said, dear lady, I don't give a rat's..."
"Glerk!"
the witch shouted, aghast.
"Language!"
"Apologies,"
Glerk said mildly, though he really didn't mean it. He eased both sets of arms onto the muck at the shore, pressing each seven-fingered hand into the shine of the mud. With a grunt, he heaved himself onto the grass.
"This used to be easier," he thought, though for the life of him he couldn't remember when.
"Fyrian is over there by the vents, crying his eyes out, poor thing,"
Zan fumed. Glerk sighed deeply. Zan thrust her staff onto the ground, sending a spray of sparks from the tip, surprising them both. She glared at the swamp monster.
"And you are just being mean," she shook her head. "He's only a baby, after all."
"My dear Zan,"
Glerk said, feeling a rumble deep in his chest, which he hoped sounded imposing and dramatic, and not like someone who was simply coming down with a cold.
"He is also older than you are, and it is high time."
"Oh, you know what I mean. And anyway, I promised his mother."
"For 500 years, give or take a decade or two, that dragonling has persisted in these delusions, fed and perpetuated by you, my dear. How is this helping him? He is not a simply enormous dragon. At this point, there is no indication that he ever will be. There is no shame at all in being a perfectly tiny dragon. Size isn't everything, you know. His is an ancient and honorable species, filled with some of the greatest thinkers of the seven ages. He has much to be proud of."
"His mother was very clear," Zan began, but the monster interrupted her.
"In any case, the time is long past that he know his heritage and his place in the world. I've gone along with this fiction for far longer than I should have. But now..."
Glerk pressed his forearms to the ground and eased his massive bottom under the curve of his spine, letting his heavy tail curl around the whole of him like a great, glistening snail's shell. He let the paunch of his belly sag over his folded legs.
"I don't know, my dear. Something has shifted."
A cloud passed over his damp face, but Zan shook her head.
"Here we go again," she scoffed.
"As the poet says, oh, ever-changed earth."
"Hang the poet. Go apologize. Do it right now. He looks up to you."
Zan glanced at the sky. "I must fly, my dear. I'm already late.
Please. I am counting on you."
Glerk lumbered toward the witch,
who laid her hand on his great cheek. Though he was able to walk upright, he often preferred to move on all sixes, or all sevens, with the use of his tail as an occasional limb, or all fives, if he happened to be using one of his hands to pluck a particularly fragrant flower and bring it to his nose, or to collect rocks, or to play a haunting tune on a hand-carved flute. He pressed his massive forehead to Zan's tiny brow.
"Please be careful,"
he said, his voice thick.
"I have been beset of late by troubling dreams. I worry about you when you are gone."
Zan raised her eyebrows, and Glerk leaned his face away with a low grumble.
"Fine," he said. "I will perpetuate the fiction for our friend Fyrian. The path to truth is in the dreaming heart, the poet tells us."
"That's the spirit," Zan said. She clucked her tongue and blew the monster a kiss, and she vaulted up and forward on her staff's fulcrum, sprinting away into the green. Despite the odd beliefs of the people of the Protectorate, the forest was not cursed at all, nor was it magical in any way. But it was dangerous. The volcano beneath the forest, low-sloped and impossibly wide, was a tricky thing. It grumbled as it slept, while heating geysers till they burst and restlessly worrying at fissures until they grew so deep that no one could find the bottom. It boiled streams and cooked mud and sent waterfalls disappearing into deep pits only to reappear miles away. There were vents that spewed foul odors and vents that spewed ash and vents that seemed to spew nothing at all until a person's lips and fingernails turned blue from bad air and the whole world started to spin. The only true safe passage across the forest for an ordinary person was the road, which was situated on a naturally raised seam of rock that had smoothed over time. The road didn't alter or shift. It never grumbled. Unfortunately, it was owned and operated by a gang of thugs and bullies from the Protectorate. Zan never took the road. She couldn't abide thugs or bullies. And anyway, they charged too much. Or they did last time she checked. It had been years since she had gone near it, many centuries now. She made her own way instead, using a combination of magic and know-how and common sense. Her treks across the forest weren't easy by any means, but they were necessary. A child was waiting for her just outside the Protectorate, a child whose very life depended on her arrival, and she needed to get there in time. For as long as Zan could remember, every year at about the same time, a mother from the Protectorate left her baby in the forest, presumably to die. Zan had no idea why, nor did she judge. But she wasn't going to let the poor little thing perish either, and so every year she traveled to that circle of sycamores and gathered the abandoned infant in her arms, carrying the child to the other side of the forest, to one of the free cities on the other side of the road. These were happy places, and they loved children. At the curve of the trail, the walls of the Protectorate came into view. Zan's quick steps slowed to a plod. The Protectorate itself was a dismal place. Bad air, bad water, sorrow settling over the roofs of its houses like a cloud. She felt a yoke of sadness settle onto her own bones. "Just get the baby and go," Zan reminded herself, as she did every year. Over time, Zan had started making certain preparations. A blanket woven of the softest lamb's wool to wrap the child and keep it warm. A stack of cloths to freshen a wet bottom. A bottle or two of goat's milk to fill an empty tummy. When the goat's milk ran out, as it invariably did, the trek was long and milk is heavy, Zan did what any sensible witch would do. Once it was dark enough to see the stars, she reached up one hand and gathered starlight in her fingers, like the silken threads of spiders' webs, and fed it to the child. Starlight, as every witch knows, is a marvelous food for a growing infant. Starlight collection takes a certain knack and talent, magic for starters, but children eat it with gusto. They grow fat and sated and shining. It didn't take long for the free cities to treat the yearly arrival of the witch as something of a holiday. The children she brought with her, their skin and eyes bright with starlight, were seen as a blessing. Zan took her time selecting the proper family for each child, making sure their characters and inclinations and senses of humor were a good match for the little life that she had cared for over the course of such a long journey. And the star children, as they were called, grew from happy infants to kind adolescents to gracious adults. They were accomplished, generous of spirit, and successful. When they died of old age, they died rich. When Zan arrived at the grove, there was no baby to be seen, but it was still early, and she was tired. She went to one of the craggy trees and leaned against it, taking in the loamy scent of its bark through the soft beak of her nose. "A little sleep might do me good," she said out loud. And it was true, too. The journey she'd been on was long and taxing, and the journey she was about to begin was longer and more taxing. Best to dig in and rest a while. And so, as she often did when she wanted some peace and quiet away from home, the witch Zan transformed herself into a tree, a craggy thing of leaf and lichen and deep-grooved bark, similar in shape and texture to the other ancient sycamores standing guard over the small grove. And as a tree, she slept. She didn't hear the procession. She didn't hear the protestations of Antane, or the embarrassed silence of the council, or the gruff pontifications of Grand Elder Gerland. She didn't even hear the baby when it cooed, or when it whimpered, or when it cried. But when the child opened its throat into a full-fledged wail, Zan woke up with a start.
"Oh, my precious stars," she said in her craggy, barky, leafy voice, for she had not yet untransformed. "I did not see you lying there."
The baby was not impressed. She continued to kick and flail and howl and weep. Her face was ruddy and rageful, and her tiny hands curled into fists. The birthmark on her forehead darkened dangerously.
"Just give us a second, my darling. Auntie Zan is going as fast as she is able."
And she was. Transformation is a tricky business, even for one as skilled as Zan. Her branches began to wind back into her spine, one by one, while the folds of bark were devoured, bit by the folds of her wrinkles. Zan leaned on her staff and rolled back her shoulders a few times to release the kinks in her neck, one side and then the other. She looked down at the child, who had quieted some, and was now staring at the witch in the same way that she had stared at the Grand Elder, with a calm, probing, unsettling gaze. It was the sort of gaze that reached into the tight strings of the soul and plucked like the strings of a harp. It nearly took the witch's breath away.
"Bottle," Zan said, trying to ignore the harmonics ringing in her bones. "You need a bottle."
And she searched her many pockets to find a bottle of goat's milk, ready and waiting for a hungry belly. With a flick of her ankle, Zan allowed a mushroom to enlarge itself enough to make a fine stool to sit upon. She let the child's warm weight rest against the soft lump of her midsection and waited. The crescent moon on the child's forehead dimmed to a pleasant shade of pink, and her dark curls framed her darker eyes. Her face shone like a jewel. She was calm and content with the milk, but her gaze still bored into Zan, like tree roots hooking into the ground. Zan grunted.
"Well," she said, "there's no use looking at me like that. I can't bring you back to where you were. That's all gone now, so you might as well forget about it." "Oh, hush now," for the child began to whimper. "Don't cry. You'll love the place where we're going. Once I decide which city to bring you to, they are all perfectly nice, and you'll love your new family, too. I'll see to that."
But just saying so made an ache in Zan's old heart, and she was, all at once, unaccountably sad. The child pulled away from the bottle and gave Zan a curious expression. The witch shrugged.
"Well, don't ask me," she said. "I have no idea why you were left in the middle of the woods. I don't know why people do half the things they do, and I shake my head at the other half."
But I am certainly not going to leave you here on the ground to feed some common stoat. You've got better things ahead of you, precious child.
The word precious caught strangely in Zan's throat. She couldn't understand it. She cleared the debris from her old lungs and gave the girl a smile. She leaned toward the baby's face and pressed her lips against the child's brow. She always gave the babies a kiss. At least she was pretty sure she did. The child's scalp smelled like bread dough and clabbering milk. Zan closed her eyes, only for a moment, and shook her head.
Come now,
she said, her voice thick.
Let's go see the world, shall we?
And wrapping the baby securely in a sling, Zan marched into the woods, whistling as she walked. And she would have gone straight to the free cities, she certainly intended to. But there was a waterfall that the baby would like, and there was a rocky outcropping with a particularly fine view, and she noticed herself wanting to tell the baby stories and sing her songs. And as she told and as she sang, Zan's step grew slower and slower and slower. Zan blamed the onset of old age and the crick in her back and the fussiness of the child, but none of those things was true. Zan found herself stopping again and again just to take yet another opportunity to unsling the baby and stare into those deep, black eyes. Each day, Zan's path wandered farther afield. It looped, doubled back, and wiggled. Her traverse through the forest, normally almost as straight as the road itself, was a twisty, windy mess. At night, once the goat's milk was exhausted, Zan gathered the gossamer threads of starlight on her fingers, and the child ate gratefully, and each mouthful of starlight deepened the darkness in the child's gaze. Whole universes burned in those eyes, galaxies upon galaxies. After the 10th night, the journey that usually only took 3.5 days was less than a quarter done. The waxing moon rose earlier each night, though Zan didn't pay it much mind. She reached up and gathered her starlight and didn't heed the moon. There is magic in starlight, of course, this is well known. But because the light travels such a long distance, the magic in it is fragile and diffused, stretched into the most delicate of threads. There is enough magic in starlight to content a baby and fill its belly, and in large enough quantities, starlight can awaken the best in that baby's heart and soul and mind. It is enough to bless, but not to end magic. Moonlight, however, that is a different story. Moonlight is magic. Ask anyone you like. Zan couldn't take her eyes off the baby's eyes. Suns and stars and meteors, the dust of nebulae, big bangs and black holes and endless, endless space. The moon rose, big and fat and shining. Zan reached up. She didn't look at the sky. She didn't notice the moon. Did she notice how heavy the light felt on her fingers? Did she notice how sticky it was, how sweet? She waved her fingers above her head. She pulled her hand down when she couldn't hold it up anymore. Did she notice the weight of magic swinging from her wrist? She told herself she didn't. She said it over and over and over until it felt true. And the baby ate and ate and ate. And suddenly she shuddered and buckled in Zan's arms, and she cried out, once, and very loud. And then she gave a contented sigh, falling instantly asleep, pressing herself into the softness of the witch's belly. Zan looked up at the sky, feeling the light of the moon falling across her face. Oh, dear me, she whispered. The moon had grown full without her noticing. Powerfully magic. One sip would have done it, and the baby had had, well, more than one sip. Greedy little thing. In any case, the facts of the matter were as clear as the moon sitting brightly on the tops of the trees. The child had become enmagicked. There was no doubt about it. And now things were more complicated than they had been before.
Zan settled herself cross-legged on the ground and laid the sleeping child in the crook of her knee. There would be no waking her, not for hours. Zan ran her fingers through the girl's black curls. Even now, she could feel the magic pulsing under her skin, each filament insinuating itself between cells, through tissues, filling up her bones. In time, she'd become unstable. Not forever, of course. But Zan remembered enough from the magicians who raised her long ago that rearing a magic baby is no easy matter. Her teachers were quick to tell her as much. And her keeper, Zazimos, mentioned it endlessly. Infusing magic into a child is akin to putting a sword in the hand of a toddler. So much power and so little sense. Can't you see how you age me so, girl?
He had said over and over. And it was true. Magical children were dangerous. She certainly couldn't leave the child with just anyone.
Well, my love, she said, aren't you more troublesome by half?
The baby breathed deeply through her nose. A tiny smile quivered in the center of her rosebud mouth. Zan felt her heart leap within her, and she cuddled the baby close.
Luna, she said. Your name will be Luna, and I will be your grandmother, and we will be a family.
And just by saying so, Zan knew it was true. The words hummed in the air between them, stronger than any magic. She stood, slid the baby back into the sling, and began the long journey toward home, wondering how on earth she'd explain it to Glerk. Chapter 4. In which it was just a dream.
You ask too many questions. No one knows what the witch does with the children she takes. No one asks this. We can't ask it, don't you see? It hurts too much. Fine. She eats them. Are you happy?
No, that's not what I think.
My mother told me she ate their souls, and that their soulless bodies have wandered the earth ever since, unable to live, unable to die. Blank-eyed and blank-faced and aimless walking.
I don't think that's true. We would have seen them, don't you think? We would at least have seen one wander by after all these years.
My grandmother told me she keeps them as slaves, that they live in the catacombs under her great castle in the forest and operate her fell machines and stir her great cauldrons and do her bidding from morning till night.
But I don't think that's true either.
Surely if it was, at least one of them would have escaped. In all these years, surely one person would have found a way out and come home.
So no, I don't think they are enslaved. Really, I don't think anything at all. There is nothing at all to think. Sometimes I have this dream about your brother. He would be 18 now. No, 19. I have this dream that he has dark hair and luminous skin and stars in his eyes. I dream that when he smiles, it shines for miles around. Last night I dreamed that he waited next to a tree for a girl to walk by, and he called her name and held her hand, and his heart pounded when he kissed her.
What? No, I'm not crying. Why would I cry? Silly thing.
Anyway, it was just a dream.
Chapter 5. In which a swamp monster accidentally falls in love.
Glerk did not approve, and said so the first day the baby arrived. And he said so again on the next day. And the next. And the next. Zan refused to listen.
Babies, 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 sang Fyrian.
He was utterly delighted. The tiny dragon perched on the branch extending over the door of Zan's tree home, opening his multicolored wings as wide as he could and arching his long neck toward the sky. His voice was loud,
warbled and atrociously off-key. Glerk covered his ears.
Babies, 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 babies,
Fyrian continued.
Oh, how I love babies.
He had never met a baby before, at least not that he could remember, but that didn't stop the dragon from loving them all to bits. From morning till night, Fyrian sang and Zan fussed, and no one, Glerk felt, would listen to reason. By the end of the second week, their entire habitation had been transformed. Diapers and baby clothes and bonnets hung on newly strung clotheslines to dry. Freshly blown glass bottles dried on recently constructed racks next to a brand new washing station. A new goat had been procured, Glerk had no idea how, and Zan had separate milk jugs for drinking and cheese making and butter churning, and quite suddenly the floor became thoroughly strewn with toys. More than once, Glerk's foot had come down hard on a cruel-cornered wooden rattle, sending him howling with pain. He found himself shushed and needled out of the room lest he wake the baby, or frighten the baby, or bore the baby to death with poetry. By the end of the third week, he'd had quite enough.
Zan, he said, I must insist that you do not fall in love with that baby.
The old woman snorted, but she didn't answer. Glerk scowled.
Indeed, I forbid it.
The witch laughed out loud. The baby laughed with her. They were a mutual admiration society of two, and Glerk couldn't bear it.
Luna,
Fyrian sang, flying in through the open door. He flitted about the room like a tone-deaf songbird.
Luna, 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 Luna.
No more singing, Glerk snapped.
You don't have to listen to him, Fyrian dear, Zan said. Singing is good for babies. Everyone knows that.
The baby kicked and cooed. Fyrian settled on Zan's shoulder and hummed tunelessly. An improvement, to be sure, but not much. Glerk grunted in frustration.
Do you know what the poet says about witches raising children? He asked.
I cannot think what any poet might say about babies or witches, but I have no doubt that it is marvelously insightful.
She looked around. Glerk, could you please hand me that bottle? Zan sat cross-legged on the rough plank floor, and the baby lay in the hollow of her skirts. Glerk moved closer, leaned his head near the baby, and gave her a skeptical expression. The baby had her fist in her mouth, leaking drool through the fingers. She waved her other hand at the monster. Her pink lips spread outward into a wide smile around her wet knuckles.
She is doing that on purpose,
he thought as he tried to force his own smile away from his wide, damp jaws.
She is being adorable as some sort of hideous ruse to spite me. What a mean baby.
Luna gave a giggly squeal and kicked her tiny feet. Her eyes caught the swamp monster's eyes, and they sparkled like stars.
Do not fall in love with that baby, he ordered himself.
He tried to be stern. Glerk cleared his throat.
The poet,
he said with emphasis, and narrowed his eyes on the baby,
says nothing about witches and babies.
Well then,
Zan said, touching her nose to the baby's nose and making her laugh. She did it again, and again.
I suppose we don't have to worry then. Oh, no, we don't.
Her voice went high and sing-song, and Glerk rolled his tremendous eyes.
My dear Zan, you are missing the point.
And you are missing this babyhood with all your huffing and puffing. The child is here to stay, and that is that. Human babies are only tiny for an instant. Their growing up is as swift as the beat of a hummingbird's wing. Enjoy it, Glerk. Enjoy it or get out.
She didn't look at him when she said this, but Glerk could feel a cold prickliness emanating from the witch's shoulder, and it nearly broke his heart.
Well,
Fyrian said. He was perched on Zan's shoulder, watching the baby kick and coo with interest.
I like her.
He wasn't allowed to get too close. This, Zan explained, was for both of their safeties. The baby, full to bursting with magic, was a bit like a sleeping volcano. Internal energy and heat and power can build over time, and erupt without warning. Zan and Glerk were both mostly immune to the volatilities of magic, Zan because of her arts, and Glerk because he was older than magic and didn't truck with its foolishness, and had less to worry about. But Fyrian was delicate. Also, Fyrian was prone to the hiccups, and his hiccups were usually on fire.
"Don't get too close, Fyrian, dear. Stay behind Auntie Zan."
Fyrian hid behind the crinkly curtain of the old woman's hair, staring at the baby with a combination of fear and jealousy and longing.
"I want to play with her," he whined.
"You will,"
Zan said soothingly as she positioned the baby to take her bottle.
"I just want to make sure that the two of you don't hurt one another."
"I never would," Fyrian gasped.
Then he sniffed.
"I think I'm allergic to the baby," he said.
"You're not allergic to the baby,"
Glerk groaned, just as Fyrian sneezed a bright plume of fire onto the back of Zan's head. She didn't even flinch. With a wink of her eye, the fire transformed to steam, which lifted several spit-up stains that she had not bothered to clean yet from her shoulders.
"Bless you, dear," Zan said. "Glerk, why don't you take our Fyrian for a walk?"
"I dislike walks,"
Glerk said, but took Fyrian anyway.
Or Glerk walked, and Fyrian fluttered behind from side to side and forward and back like a troublesome, overlarge butterfly.
Primarily, Fyrian decided to occupy himself in the collection of flowers for the baby, a process hindered by his occasional hiccups and sneezes, each with its requisite dollops of flame and each reducing his flowers to ashes. But he hardly noticed. Instead, Fyrian was a fountain of questions.
"Will the baby grow up to be a giant like you and Zan?" he asked. "There must be more giants, then, in the wider world, I mean, the world past here. How I long to see the world beyond here, Glerk. I want to see all the giants in all the world and all the creatures who are bigger than I."
Fyrian's delusions continued unabated, despite Glerk's protestations. Though he was about the same size as a dove, Fyrian continued to believe he was larger than the typical human habitation and that he needed to be kept far away from humanity lest he be accidentally seen and start a worldwide panic.
"When the time is right, my son,"
his massive mother had told him in the moments before she plunged herself into the erupting volcano, leaving this world forever.
"You will know your purpose. You are and will be a giant upon this fair earth. Never forget it."
Her meaning, Fyrian felt, was clear. He was simply enormous. There was no doubt about it. Fyrian reminded himself of it every single day. And for 500 years, Glerk continued to fume.
"The child will grow as children do, I expect,"
Glerk said evasively. And when Fyrian persisted, Glerk pretended to take a nap in the calla lily bog and kept his eyes closed until he actually slept. Raising a baby, magical or not, is not without its challenges. The inconsolable crying, the near constant runny noses, the obsession with putting very small objects into a drooling mouth, and the noise.
"Can you please magic her quiet?"
Fyrian had begged once the novelty of a baby in the family had worn off. Zan refused, of course.
"Magic should never be used to influence the will of another person, Fyrian," Zan told him over and over. "How could I do the thing that I must instruct her to never do once she knows how to understand? That's hypocrisy, is what."
Even when Luna was content, she still was not quiet. She hummed, she gurgled, she babbled, she screeched, she guffawed, she snorted, she yelled. She was a waterfall of sound, pouring, 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 and she never stopped. She even babbled in her sleep. Glerk made a sling for Luna that hung from all four of his shoulders as he walked on all sixes. He took to pacing with the baby from the swamp, past the workshop, past the castle ruin, and back again, reciting poetry as he did so. He did not intend to love the baby. And yet.
"From grain of sand," recited the monster,
births light, births space, births infinite time, and two grain of sand do all things return.
It was one of his favorites. The baby gazed as he walked, studying his protruding eyeballs, his conical ears, his thick lips on wide jaws. She examined each wart, each divot, each slimy lump on his large, flat face, a look of wonder in her eyes. She reached up one finger and stuck it curiously into a nostril. Glerk sneezed, and the child laughed.
Glerk,
the baby said, though it was probably a hiccup or a burp. Glerk didn't care. She said his name. She said it. His heart nearly burst in his chest. Zan, for her part, did her best not to say, "I told you so." She mostly succeeded. In that first year, both Zan and Glerk watched the baby for any sign of magical eruption. Though they could both see the oceans of magic thrumming just under the child's skin, and they could feel it, too, each time they carried that girl in their arms, it remained inside her, a surging, unbroken wave. At night, moonlight and starlight bent toward the baby, flooding her cradle. Zan covered the windows with heavy curtains, but she would find them thrown open, and the child drinking moonlight in her sleep. The moon, Zan told herself, it is full of tricks. But a whisper of worry remained. The magic continued to silently surge. In the second year, the magic inside Luna increased, nearly doubling in density and strength. Glerk could feel it. Zan could feel it too. Still, it did not erupt.
Magical babies are dangerous babies,
Glerk tried to remind himself day after day when he wasn't cradling Luna or singing to Luna or whispering poetry into her ear as she slept. After a while, even the thrum of magic under her skin began to seem ordinary. She was an energetic child, a curious child, a naughty child. And that was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.